أفلا يتدبرون القرآن
ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم still with verses in Surah An-Nisa and in this episode inshallah ta'ala we'll talk about verses from 110 to 113 110 to 113 from Surah An-Nisa and the verses are continuation of the previous set of verses that talked about an incident that happened at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam where a man stole something from someone else and he accused a Jewish man in Al-Medina to be the thief and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam being the judge among them he was about to make the verdict based on the evidences that are being presented when they put the thing that was stolen in the house of that Jewish man that he was innocent then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed these ayat to expose the evil action of this deceitful individual, this munafiq, this hypocrite, and claiming or making the matter so clear that this Jewish man was an innocent person. And we explained how the justice from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is something that should never be compromised, even with the most fierce enemy to oneself, because justice is something that has to be absolute because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just. Then after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these verses from 110 to 113 talks about the forgiveness and the sins and how to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the outcome of sins when a person does not repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or when people would accuse others or would wrongdoing themselves by accusing others of a sin that they didn't do and the implications of that which is definitely knowledge that we are in need of and we need to witness the vast mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. And we would see in the verses that how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened the gates of forgiveness for the human beings to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It doesn't matter how evil and how major and how big the sin is, if a person sincerely wants to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is always a way out as long as the person is still alive. So let's inshallah ta'ala recite and reflect upon these verses and get to learn so that we change our life and we follow the Quran and the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. So we start with ayah number 110 from Surah An-Nisa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ سُوءًا أَوْ يَظْلِمْ نَفْسَهُ ثُمَّ يَسْتَغْفِرِ اللَّهَ يَجِدِ اللَّهَ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا which means and whoever does a wrong or wrongs himself but then seeks forgiveness of Allah will find Allah forgiving and merciful and the continuation of that in the next verses inshallah ta'ala but first وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ سُوءًا whoever do سُوء is a wrong doing and it's called سُوء because it affects the person and it causes one's iman to be weak It causes the person to be subjected to the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hereafter. So any su', any wrongdoing, whether it's major or minor, any type of wrongdoing, whoever do it, أو يظلم نفسه, or commit injustice against oneself, and we talked about that before, wronging oneself, whether it's shirk, associating partners with Allah, or sins in general, or attacking someone and committing injustice or oppression against someone else whoever do any act of sin wrongdoing against others or against oneself then ثم يستغفر الله then he seeks forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala he would find yajid means he would find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala غفوراً رحيماً he would find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the most forgiving and the most merciful subhanahu wa ta'ala This is a beautiful verse, and this is the call from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, calling humanity and calling the wrongdoers, and calling no matter what the person did wrong in his life, if he would seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the right way, sincerely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he would find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most forgiving and he's the most merciful subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma and others, they said this is a call from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to show the vast mercy of Allah and the forbearance and the generosity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that although he warned the human beings and warned the believers from disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he subhanahu wa ta'ala is the owner of all things, and when the matter made clear that certain things are forbidden for people to do, and they understood that very well, and then they intentionally, or they committed these sins and they wronged their own selves by committing these sins, that means they deserve to be punished by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if justice is served, then they will be punished. They have to be punished because this is what the consequence of their actions. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. A dhanb or the sin is when a person commit a sin, he is in trouble. He is in some form of a difficult situation. And this difficult situation is that he deserves to be punished in the hellfire. That a sin can lead the person astray and to be deviated from the truth, and even lead the person to kufr and disbelief, wal'ayadhu billah. So this is a very serious matter, and the person is in trouble, the person is in a difficult situation, and no one would like to continue to be in such a difficult situation. Everybody would want to come out of it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most merciful, he shows us how can a person get out of the situation of being a sinner or a wrongdoer by doing what? ثُمَّ يَسْتَغْفِرِ اللَّهِ الْإِسْتَغْفَارِ, to seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the means to get oneself away and to free oneself from the chains of the sins, from the outcome and the consequences of the sins, which is every misery on the face of earth. And every misery in the hereafter, it's because of the sins of the people. And if a person repents to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he free himself from this wrongdoing, and then he would receive the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So our job is to make istighfar. ثُمَّ يَسْتَغْفِرِ اللَّهِ. And to make istighfar is not simply just to say astaghfirullah, to say, oh Allah, forgive me, but it's something that has to be in the heart and in the tongue. And this refers to the tawbah, to the repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the person would repent to Allah, and a tawbah in Arabic means to return, because when a person commits a sin, he takes himself away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, away from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So to return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by seeking forgiveness from him subhanahu wa ta'ala, to stay away from the sin, to regret the sin, and to have the strong intention and the will not to commit the sin again. And then to say with one's tongue and the heart is full of these meanings of istighfar, that a person would say, oh Allah, forgive me. So he would seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the believers, they know that the only one that forgives is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so they turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And this is the sign of the tawheed, the sign of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And this is the meaning of a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased when his slave would turn to him alone subhanahu wa ta'ala seeking forgiveness. And he would say, عَلِمَ أَنَّ لَهُ رَبًّا يَغْفِرُ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say that this slave of Allah, he knew that there is a Rabb, there is a Lord, the creator of the heavens and the earth, and he forgives. That's why he turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the sign that a person is a worshipper of Allah, that a person believes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one worthy of worship. So it's an ibadah by itself. It's ibadah for a person to seek forgiveness from Allah. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ used to do that every day, 100 times, as he said, alayhi salatu wasalam, and in the morning and in the evening. And with this ibadah, the person, he is seeking sincere and true forgiveness. Otherwise, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not forgive our sins, then we are in the hellfire. So, ثُمَّ يَسْتَغْفِرِ اللَّهِ. Beautiful action here It's a way of life of the believers. They constantly repent and seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there are many ahadith about this, about the virtue of al-istighfar, and we should make it as a habit in our life every day, in the morning and in the evening. And whenever a person fell weak into some form of a sin, whether it's major or minor, to immediately repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to take the means that will expiate the sins, the five daily salah, the Jumu'ah to Jumu'ah, Ramadan to Ramadan, Umrah to Umrah, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, and to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to ask for forgiveness before Fajr, which is a very precious time, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about the believers, and he said, وَالْمُسْتَغْفِرِينَ بِالْأَسْحَارِ, they seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the time of As-Sahar, before Fajr. So to take the matter serious, basically, and to seek forgiveness from Allah, and whether to say Astaghfirullah, like this, Astaghfirullah, or Astaghfirullah al-Azim, or Astaghfirullah al-Azim wa atubu ilayh. Or there's a hadith in Sunan Abi Dawood where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, whoever say Astaghfirullah alladhi la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyu al-qayyum wa atubu ilayh, whoever says this three times, his sins will be forgiven, even if he fled from the battlefield, which is a major sin. If he says this three times, Astaghfirullah alladhi la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyu al-qayyum wa atubu ilayh, which basically shows how the believers, they establish the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when they're seeking forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Astaghfirullah, I seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that there is no one worthy of worship except Him, the ever living Al-Qayyum, that everything, all the creation of Allah in need of Him, and I repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So saying these words and the blessings of following the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam makes it easy for the person to have the sins forgiven. So again, Astaghfirullah alladhi la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyu al-qayyum wa atubu ilayh. Whoever seek forgiveness from Allah, or whatever means a person would seek help and forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a person would find yajidillaha ghafuran rahima, he would find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the most forgiver and the most merciful subhanahu wa ta'ala. These two names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Ghafur, the most forgiving, and Ar-Rahim, the most merciful. And they're both together because it shows how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He forgives the sins, then there is no outcome of it. A person would never be miserable as a result of that sin if the sin is forgiven, because He's the most merciful subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Rahim is a special mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the believers, when He would forgive their sins and bestow His mercy upon them. And when a person fall into a sin, maybe he would lose many of the good things and his iman and so on. But when a person repents to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive that person and have mercy on him, all of the good things will be returned back to him, all the good things and the good deeds and so on. So this is a call from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the believers to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and never to be in despair, because to be in despair from the mercy of Allah is the way of shaitan to get the human beings away from forgiving, or from forgiveness and from seeking forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this ayah clearly states that, and then more with the meaning of how to do when a person falls into a sin, major sin or minor sin, more of the knowledge is mentioned in these verses, as the next verse, number 111, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ يَكْسِبْ إِثْمًا فَإِنَّمَا يَكْسِبُهُ عَلَى نَفْسِهِ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَلِيمًا حَكِيمًا. And whoever commits a sin only earns it against himself, and Allah is ever knowing and wise. So after the call in the previous verse that whoever commit a sin, if he seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he would find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the most forgiving, the most merciful. Then this ayah comes after that to warn, and not to be deceived by the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most forgiving and the most merciful, to make the person continue to commit sins and to say, every time I commit a sin, I seek forgiveness from Allah and I will be forgiven. You know, this is not the proper attitude of the person. Although every time a person falls into a sin and he returns to Allah with repentance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most forgiving. But then to warn that whoever earns a sin or so, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the all-knower. But we'll expand on this meaning, inshallah ta'ala, right after the break. So stay with us.
يتدبرون
القرآن
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Continuing the verses from 110 to 113 in Surah An-Nisa about sins and forgiveness and how to deal with these sins, which is really a difficult situation, and we have to see sins as an evil thing, to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful and He's the most forgiving subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever difficult situation that a person is in, there's ways out if we really have the knowledge and we have the courage and the patience to take the steps to elevate ourselves and to take ourselves away from these difficult situation that a person would put himself in by disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So after we heard about the vast mercy of Allah, that He's the most forgiving, the most merciful, and no matter what a person do, if he seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept the repentance of His slaves that are sincere to Him, with the rulings of repentance, of course. But then after that, the next verse, which is 111, warns those who commit sins that do not rely on this fact and make the person just continuously to be persistent in committing the sins without repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because the reality of the sins is in such a way, as it's explained in this verse, this is the reality of things, and we should see it this way. وَمَنْ يَكْسِبْ إِثْمًا, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whoever earns إِثْمًا, any sin, and it's mentioned in the nakira, or not a specific sin, any sin, whoever earns it. And the word yaksib means earns. So when a person earns a sin, you know, as if a person, he earned it himself, he committed the sin, right? He earns it. And he, as if when you go out and you earn money and it becomes your money, the same thing when it comes to sins, a person earned this evil to his own self and it becomes part of him unless he detach himself from it and he repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَنْ يَكْسِبْ إِثْمًا فَإِنَّمَا يَكْسِبُهُ عَلَى نَفْسِهِ. In reality, he's earning this sin to his own self. فَإِنَّمَا gives the meaning of exclusiveness, that in reality, this sin is earned for one own self, even if it's something that is separated from the person, you know, did for someone else, committed injustice against someone else, hurt someone, backbited someone, right? A person might think that he had hurted others, which is true, but in reality, who's the one that is really hurt is the sin that is committed from the, is the sinner himself. He's the one that committed that sin, so he earned it to himself. And that's why in the Day of Judgment, who would come in state of regret and subjected to the punishment of Allah? Not the one that got hurt in this life, but the one that hurted others, the one that committed injustice. So when a person sees the reality of things, the most of the individuals that should fear and should have feel of regret is the one that is the wrongdoer himself, and not the one that is being oppressed or the one that injustice has been committed against, because he did not wrong others, and in reality it's earning to oneself. And as it always said, when a person do wrong, he's just earning it for his own self, he is doing it to his own self, he's harming his own self. وَمَنْ يَكْسِبْ إِثْمًا فَإِنَّمَا يَكْسِبُهُ عَلَى نَفْسِهِ. And once this reality is present in the heart, this is one of the means to be away from sins, and one of the means to make the person rush into seeking forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَلِيمًا حَكِيمًا, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the all-knower, and He is the most wise subhanahu wa ta'ala. He knows who committed what and who is the wrongdoer, and He's the most wise, that He subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that ordered the believers to be away from certain acts, because this is sinful acts, and He's the one that legislated for His ummah what is right and what is wrong. So He's the most wise subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He's the all-knower. So people need to be watchful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We might deceive others, people might see us as righteous individuals, as good people, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best what's in our hearts, and He's the most wise subhanahu wa ta'ala. And a person should not be deceived by the praise of others, by how people are treating him or her. People should be watchful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He knows what's in the hearts and our true actions and our true intentions and so on. So this ayah clearly warns against being deceived by one's sins And the sins, when a person commits it, he is basically earning it for his own self, making himself in such a difficult situation unless he repents to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the next verse, and it's all related to the incident that happened at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when a person, he committed the sin and he accused others that they did it. So he wronged himself by committing the sin and wronged others by accusing them when they are innocent of committing the sin that he committed. So the next verse, which shows this serious and this major evil that a person might incur upon himself, in verse number 112, وَمَنْ يَكْسِبْ خَطِيئَةً أَوْ إِثْمًا ثُمَّ يَرْمِي بِهِ بَرِيئًا فَقَدْ احْتَمَلَ بُهْتَانًا وَإِثْمًا مُبِينًا. Which means, but whoever earns an offense or a sin and then blames it on an innocent person has taken upon himself a slander and manifest sin. So this is another level. وَمَنْ يَكْسِبْ خَطِيئَةً أَوْ إِثْمًا. Whoever earns, يَكْسِبْ, again the word يَكْسِبْ, earns, he earns it, he earns the sin, it becomes part of him. خَطِيئَةً أَوْ إِثْمًا. خَطِيئَةً, whether it's, as you see, an offense or a sin, it's both means sin. And the ulama, when they talked about this, they said one refers to the minor sin and one refers to the major sin. So it doesn't matter whether it's a major or a minor sin. And the differences between both is basically by looking into the text, into the evidences in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whenever a sin is mentioned with a specific punishment, then this is a major sin. But the sins that are mentioned without a specific punishment attached to it, then this can be in the category of a minor sin. And the heart, when it becomes persistent in committing a particular sin, then this attitude of the heart is a major sin. So whether it's major or minor, whoever earns a sin, committed a sin, disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by the way, how do we know that an act is a sinful act? It's not based on what we like or what we dislike, it's based on the wahy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected this religion. So it's all in the Quran and in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Al-haram, or what sinful acts, is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declared to be haram and forbidden for us, Him subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And what is permissible is what's permissible, mentioned in the Quran and in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's not for an individual, it's not for an imam, for a sheikh, or for whatever, to make or to legislate for the people what is right and what is wrong. But of course, we ask the people of knowledge because they have the knowledge of what's in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So whoever earns and commits a sin, whether it's major or minor, but then here's the evil, more evil, ثُمَّ يَرْمِي بِهِ بَرِيئًا. Then he accuses an innocent person for the sin that he committed. And the word yarmi is when you physically throw something. This is al-rami, when you throw something. So you throw the innocent person with your sin. See how physical, the matter sounds very physical. Many people, they don't witness the sin as a physical matter, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it very graphic, if it's correct to say that, very clear for us to stay away from sins. If these actions, if sins are made to be or to have some physical image to it in our life, many people would run away from it. If we see things in the right form, many people would abhor the sin and run away from it. If people get to see the shayateen, for example, when they're whispering to them, they would run away from this. But this is how life is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the matter ghaib, or unseen to us. But we get to know the ghaib, or the unseen, by reciting the Quran and knowing the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when a person accuses others of a sin that he himself did, as if he threw that person with the sin, ثُمَّ يَرْمِي بِهِ بَرِيئًا. And the word يَرْمِي بِهِ بَرِيئًا, it's mentioned in other places in the Quran, one of which is slandering. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in Surah An-Nur. Those who slander or accuse women, for example, for committing adultery or fornication, and how the punishment of them is very severe, the same word is mentioned. ثُمَّ يَرْمِي بِهِ بَرِيئًا. So whenever he commit the wrongdoing and he accuse others, بَرِيئًا, the bari is the one that is innocent. He did not do any wrong, but he become accused by the actions of someone else. So what is the sin of that person? فَقَدْ احْتَمَلَ بُهْتَانًا وَإِثْمًا مُبِينًا. احْتَمَل means he had taken upon himself. When you carry something on your back, right, this is how the person would carry the sin. بُهْتَانًا, the بُهْتَان is the slander. The buhtan is when a sin is done or a person would claim something that is a lie and accusing others, because this would become a mean for one's shame, maybe for the rest of one's life. And people might forget about what has been accused, but it continues to be part of that life of that person. One of which is especially the slandering when it comes to matters of chastity. If a woman is accused of committing adultery, for example, even if she's innocent, what happens? Then it becomes something that is attached to that person, maybe for the rest of their life. People, for example, a man would not want to get married to that woman because she's been accused of such a crime, for example, even if she's innocent. So it ruins one's reputation, it ruins one's image in one's community, and plus it's such an evil thing, as we said, as if someone killed someone else or stole the money of someone else. How evil it is when a person transgresses his limits to wrong others. You know, as we know that sins are of two types. The sins that only relates to the person. A person commits a sin and it's not going or extended to others. You know, it's only affecting the person, the one that committed the sin. It's a sin and it's haram, and a person needs to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But what's worse is when a person's sin involves other individuals, attacking others, hurting others physically or financially, or accusing innocent people of something that they didn't do, as we heard in the story in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or basically calling others to commit sins. You know, it's one level that a person is a sinner, and another level, what's much worse, is to call others to commit the same sin, to be a caller to a sin. Then that person would carry more and more of the burden on his back. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, فَقَدْ احْتَمَلْ. And when we, again picturing this, he carries on his back, he endured that upon himself, بُهْتَانًا, slandering, which is a major, major sin, وَإِثْمًا مُبِينًا, and a clear and manifest sin. Al-Buhtan is something that the Prophet ﷺ also mentioned in one of the hadith when he talked about al-ghiba or backbiting. And he said, عليه الصلاة والسلام, in the authentic hadith, that he asked the companions radiallahu anhum, أتدرون ما الغيبة? Do you know what الغيبة is? They said, Allah and His Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم knows best. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to them, ذكرك أخاك بما أكره. When you mention your brother by something that he hates or dislikes, this is backbiting. When you would mention someone with something that he does not like for you to say, whether it's true or not true. If it's true, that's غيبة, right? So when people talk about others behind their back, by something that they have in them, whether it's a physical appearance or evil actions that they do, that's not permissible to say that. So one of the companions, or they asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they said, أَرَأَيْتَ إِن كَانَ فِي أَخِي مَا أَقُولُ. If, O Prophet of Allah, if what I'm saying about this brother, which I'm saying in a negative way about him, if he has what I'm saying, I'm not lying, I'm saying the truth. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said to him, إِن كَانَ فِي أَخِيكَ مَا تَقُولُ فَقَدْ اغْتَبْتَ. If what you're saying about your brother is present in him, you had indeed committed ghiba, which is backbiting, which is a major sin. This is what it is. You're not lying, you're saying the truth about him, but still it's a sinful act. And then the Prophet ﷺ, he said, and if you're saying something that is not in him, فَقَدْ بَهَتَّ. If you're saying something about him that is not true, then you committed what is even worse, which is al-buhtan. فَقَدْ بَهَتَّ. You had slandered this brother, which is far worse than even al-ghiba, which is already a major sin. So al-buhtan is to say something or to accuse something, or to accuse someone of something that he didn't do. And the person who's the one that is carrying all of this burden is the one that earned the sin, and he accused others, innocent people, of doing that sin. فَقَدْ احْتَمَلَ بُهْتَانًا وَإِثْمًا مُبِينًا. إِثْمًا مُبِينًا, a manifest sin, a clear sin, no doubt about it whatsoever. And as we see in the context, as if this is a sin that is the tawbah or the repentance from it is more difficult. This is deeper in wrongdoing oneself. Still there's a way out, and a person can still repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it's a more difficult one. And that's why a person has to be warned to be away from these types of sins, because it makes it difficult for the person to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the damage can be so much right, that a person would you know, carry all of this burden. فَقَدْ احْتَمَلَ بُهْتَانًا وَإِثْمًا مُبِينًا. And the word احْتَمَل, to people in the Day of Judgment, they come carrying on their backs what they stole, as the Prophet ﷺ said in the authentic hadith, that the thief comes in the Day of Judgment on his back what he had stole from others. Exposing oneself in front of all humanity in the Day of Judgment, he earned it himself. And we continue inshallah ta'ala with more of these beautiful meanings to warn ourselves and to be away from disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us benefit from these verses, but we'll continue after the break, so stay with us inshallah. Alhamdulillah, salatu wassalamu ala Rasulillah. Still with the set of verses in Surah An-Nisa from 110 to 113, and it talks about sins and how to seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the different levels of sins, and how that when a person commits a sin and accuses innocent people of the sin that he committed, this is a far worse sin than other sins. And that's the buhtan, that's the slandering, that's the clear and manifest sin that makes repentance more difficult. But still a person should repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most forgiving, the most merciful subhanahu wa ta'ala. And not to forget the incident that when these verses were revealed because of this man in Medina, when he accused a Jewish man of stealing when he didn't, and he's the one that committed that sin. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed these verses to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was about to give the verdict against an innocent man, to accuse him of stealing, because the evidence was right on him, and they found what he had stolen in his house, in the house of the innocent man. So the Prophet ﷺ was about to give the verdict based on the evidence that are being presented. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of his mercy, revealed to the Prophet ﷺ, protecting him from making the wrong judgment. Although the Prophet ﷺ, of course, this is not a sinful thing for the Prophet ﷺ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected the Prophet ﷺ from any sin. And when a person is in the position of a qadi or a judge, you know, this is valid to happen, because the judge, he would give the verdict based on the evidences that are being presented. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from even that by revealing to him the truth about the matter, and the truth became clear, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala freed that innocent person from the blame. And then in verse number 113 talks about this, relates to this matter, after explaining that whoever earns a sin and he accused others, he had committed slander and a manifest sin. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in verse 113, وَلَوْلَا فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكَ وَرَحْمَتُهُ لَهَمَّ طَائِفَةٌ مِّنْهُمْ أَن يُضِلُّوكَ وَمَا يُضِلُّونَ إِلَّا أَنفُسَهُمْ وَمَا يَضُرُّونَكَ مِنْ شَيْءٍ وأنزل الله عليك الكتاب والحكمة وعلمك ما لم تكن تعلم وكان فضل الله عليك عظيما. Which means, if it was not for the favor of Allah upon you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and His mercy, a group of them would have determined to mislead you. But they do not mislead except themselves, and they would not harm you at all. So وَلَوْلَا فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكَ. The ayah starts with لَوْلَا, which means, and if it was not, right? So something that would have been there and present, which is not something pleasant, unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had bestowed His mercy on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa, which is the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa. وَلَوْلَا فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكَ وَرَحْمَتُهُ. If it's not for the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa rahmatuhu, and His mercy subhanahu wa ta'ala, what would have had happened? لَهَمَّ طَائِفَةٌ مِّنْهُمْ أَن يُضِلُّوكَ. That a group of them, these are the group of the family of the real thief, Tu'ma ibn Ubaydak, as it was mentioned, when they came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that this man is innocent, the thief, that he's innocent, and they accused the innocent man of committing this sin. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that this group of people, they almost deviated you from giving the right verdict, because they're swearing by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the evidence is very clear that they found what have been stolen in the house of this Jewish man. So the matter is very clear. It's a very easy case in any court in the whole entire world. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet ﷺ that this was a plot, and they accused him in the wrong way. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed these verses by the favor of Allah. And see the favor of Allah and His mercy, that the truth becomes clear. The favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the mercy, that justice is served. This is a favor from Allah and a mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Great meaning mentioned in this ayah. Some people, they think that the favor of Allah and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for them to be rich or to be healthy and so on, which is definitely from the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon a slave. But the real favor and the real mercy is when the person protected from falling into any deviation, when a person is following the truth, when a person would establish the justice. This is the real favor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَهَمَّ الطَّائِفَةٌ مِّنْهُمْ أَن يُضِلُّوكَ, that a group of them would almost make you deviated, O Prophet of Allah, from knowing the truth about this matter. وَمَا يُضِلُّونَ إِلَّا أَنفُسَهُمْ, and in reality, they are only deviating their own selves, because these group of people, when they came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, lying and accusing the innocent men, they thought that they get away with their crime or with the crime of their relative. They can save themselves from the punishment in this life, from the shame in this life. But in reality, they are deviating themselves, which is another benefit here that we need to reflect upon. Sins or accusing others can lead the person astray. And when we see someone led astray, and that's one of the most fearful things for the early generations of Islam, when people are led astray, usually there is something that they did, and as a result of that, they were led astray. Especially when a person was on the truth, and that person was guided and was among the believers, and then he was led astray afterwards. There's actions that he did, maybe something that he committed intentionally, knowing that the truth is to be away from it, but he intentionally committed it. Especially these types of actions, like accusing an innocent person of something, you know, these types of sins. So this can lead the person astray, and it's all by the favor of Allah and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that a person is guided. وَمَا يُضِلُّونَ إِلَّا أَنفُسَهُمْ, that they try to deceive you, O Prophet of Allah. They try to deviate you, O Prophet of Allah, from giving the right and the just verdict in the matter, but in reality they are deviating themselves by disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and committing the slander. وَمَا يَضُرُّونَكَ مِنْ شَيْءٍ, and more, and they would not harm you in any way or form. They would not mislead you, they would not harm you whatsoever, O Prophet of Allah, because they are wronging their own selves. They're not wronging you, especially that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, revealing to him the truth and exposing their wrongdoing. وَأَنزَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought down unto you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-kitab, the Quran, and al-hikmah, the wisdom. Whether the wisdom or the hikmah here refers to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as the ulama they say, or also it refers to the wisdom in understanding the Quran and going deeper into extracting the benefits from it, right? It's all from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَعَلَّمَكَ مَا لَمْ تَكُنْ تَعْلَمْ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught you what you did not know. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught you what you did not know. مَا لَمْ تَكُنْ تَعْلَمْ, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't know, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to him this knowledge about this specific verdict, this specific incident, and in general with all of what is mentioned in the Quran and in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it's all favors from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that are being mentioned one after the other that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then the ayah ends with وَكَانَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكَ عَظِيمًا, and the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, been great, azim and great favor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam becomes the best man ever walked on the face of earth, the best of all human beings, the best of the messengers of Allah. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised him alayhi salatu wasalam, and made his praise something that is present on the face of earth in the east and the west, and for the ummah to follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And once he was sent, there's no way for a person to enter the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unless he follows the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And all goodness comes as a result of following him alayhi salatu wasalam, and all evil comes when people turn away from the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that bestowed this favor upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So great verses, and it talks about the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It talked about human nature and how some people are so evil, and how to deal with some individuals and to warn oneself against these evil acts, and that a person sometimes he would want to commit these evil acts, but to warn oneself that it's basically where if a person do this, he's incurring that upon his own self. There's nothing going to be left like this without being brought back to the justice and to the absolute justice. We learned that from the verses. When a person is about to commit injustice, he should remember that justice has to be served. No matter what evil or how strong the person is and how he can get away with injustices, there a day will come in which justice has to be served in the most perfect way, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just. And that's why there is, if it's not in this life, then in the hereafter. And in this life, when a person commit injustices, the worst punishment is for the person to be deviated from the truth, to continue to be away from repentance, or to even die in the state of disbelief as a result of the wrongdoing that that person did, so that he would return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in such an evil state. And these are all meanings that we see in the Quran. When people would say, how come these evildoers, they kill and they spread corruption and they do all kinds of evil things, and they're still being fed and being strong, and they have all kinds of wealth and so on and so forth. Whoever asks this question, he's not really seeing things in the right way. When we read the Quran, we would understand how things are. So when a person continuously to commit injustice and evil and so on, and he's still being provided for by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he is healthy and wealthy and so on, he is receiving the worst punishment ever, and that is when he is being prevented from repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you continue to be a deviant and or to be a disbeliever, right? This is the worst punishment, because after all, it's only years. It's not centuries that a person would live on the face of earth. It's only years. If he did not receive the punishment in this life, then definitely he would receive it, or the physical punishment, then he would receive it from the moment of death, after that also till an everlasting misery if a person dies in the state of disbelief. So this is how the Quran should affect the hearts of the believers, and we should learn how to live our life and to be away from sins, and what to do when a sin is being committed, that we need to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's important to know the levels of deeds, as it is important for us to know the levels of the good deeds, what is mandatory, what is recommended, and so on, so that we do the obligatory acts in the most perfect way, and we do the recommended acts in the proper perspective. The same thing, we need to know the levels of the sins, not to belittle a sin or to be only away from major sins and it's okay to do the minor sins, but knowing the levels of sins, it has an effect when it comes to how to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to take more precautions when it comes to the major sins or sins that has to involving accusing others and so on, as we heard in the verses. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. If we're still alive, that means we have the chance to repent. We have the chance to be in the highest level if we repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to be brave enough to elevate ourselves from the consequences of the sins, to give back what people, they have rights from us and so on, all by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the real favor is when a person is guided to the truth and guided to the justice, and the real misery when a person is committing injustices and disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the proper understanding of the verses and to make us among those who are obedient to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
يتدبرون القرآن
ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا